hot and humid today. We've got some sunshine, passing clouds indicated by the gray and the white on the satellite. Nearly 90 for your afternoon high in Mineola, 88 in Merrick, and 88 in Lynbrook. Looking towards Syosset and West Prairie, I think we're going to make it to the 90-degree mark. It is hot and the humidity way up there.
And if you're lucky enough to be out on the water today, absolutely gorgeous day to do so. Temperature right along the coast around that 80-degree mark. Water temperature right around that 70-degree mark. UV index is an 8. It's very high. Always need the sunscreen. The winds are shifting from the north to the west, and we've got waves about 1 to 2 feet. Just absolutely beautiful, and it feels so comfortable to be out and about.
And got the temperature contours. You can see where the brighter shades of orange and even red indicating where the hotter temperatures are. And look at these, 93 in Toms River, 90 in Belmar now, 90 in Trenton. We've made it to 91.
And we get the thunderstorm activity again on Thursday, but with the abundant amount of moisture pushing northward from the tropical system, any rain showers that make their way through could contain some drenching downpours. But look at this, this is tomorrow. You see the heavy rain through New Jersey. The storm is well to our south, 500 miles away. So we're not getting a direct impact from this storm. The biggest impact is the moisture it's providing to the cold front that's pushing on through, but also a bigger concern is the rough surf and the rip currents as we go even into the weekend as the cold front clears the area. If you have plans to head to the beach, the ocean could be very hot today and very humid as well. You combine that with bright sunshine, it's going to lead to some unhealthy levels of ground level ozone particulate matter. So we've got an air quality alert, and this continues through the afternoon into the evening. This is mainly for sensitive groups.
Certainly a cool one.
Feels more like autumn. Look at these temperatures throughout the Midwest, into the upper Midwest, the Great Lakes, even stretching into the south. Tennessee in the 70s, low 70s toward Little Rock, through the northern plains, and the dew points so low. It really feels more like late September into October, 40s and 50s, where typically in July, see these dew points in the 60s and 70s.
We still have a moderate risk for rip currents due to Cristobal continuing to move off to the north and east. It's moving away, but it is going to continue to impact our water.
It is certainly hot. We have made it to 90 in Uniondale. Look at the colors, the bright orange and the red indicating the hot temperatures across the island. 86 in Farmingdale, upper 80s toward Islip. The good news is we do have a bit of a breeze. It's out of the northwest. It's a warm wind, but 21 miles per hour gust in Farmingdale, nearly 30 miles per hour in Glen Cove and Uniondale. It kind of cools you off. It's a nice dry breeze. And the humidity is continuing to come down as we progress throughout the afternoon. So although it is hot, it's not too uncomfortable. It's a really pretty
day. The dew points, the measure of the moisture in the air in the low 60s, not bad. But look at them in the mid to upper 60s, even 70s toward Louisville, St. Louis, Little Rock. The humidity's building in our direction. We're not going to get this oppressive, but you'll feel that jump in humidity.
Through the Great Lakes, some heavier downpours north of Chicago, and this all stretches into the south where there are some nasty storms into Georgia and the southern states, even tornado watches and warnings. This all associated with a very slow-moving system. We've got this front that's going to eventually make its way toward our area. It's pumping this moisture in.
Some showers into the Great Lakes, scattered showers through Ohio and off to our west. More activity now east of Chicago into Michigan, northwest Indiana, and northern Illinois. We're going to get some of this activity, but not until we head into the night, and more so as we get into the morning hour. So this is a look at the future cast. We're getting into the morning. We've got some showers, even a thunder shower to start the day. Yellow and orange indicating where the rain could be coming down intensely.
Okay, today, pleasantly warm conditions. We're topping out low to mid 80s, and the humidity is nice and
take advantage. The air mass over us is just so nice and comfortable. We stay nice right through the evening into tonight. Let you know about your weekend weather with your 7-day forecast coming up.
The storm developed as a tropical wave in the Caribbean Sea to the south of Jamaica, and it progressed northward, intensifying to a hurricane, a Category 1, impacting Jamaica, continuing to intensify and impacting Cuba. The map doesn't show here, but it was a Category 3 briefly, and then progressed northward into the Bahamas, weakening at one point to a tropical storm, but it was able to regain strength into a hurricane once again as it moved into the warm Gulf Stream, an environment of low wind shear. As it made its way northward, really churning up and piling up the water along with it. It was a massive storm. We had this blocking high off to our north and east, so it continue off to the north and east. And we also had this trough digging southeastward, so the storm only had one way to go. It was pulled in westward right along the Jersey Shore, piling up that water, and the wind field was so massive, over 1,100 miles, that it really did some damage and made landfall October 29th, the evening there, just to the north and east of Atlantic City. It was not a tropical storm. It lost its tropical characteristics. It was a post-tropical cyclone at landfall, but it had maximum winds 80 miles per hour, and it continued inland. As we go throughout the remainder of the work week into the weekend, we are watching a storm system, but it's nothing compared to Sandy. Let you know about the changes on the way with your 7-day
cluster of bright white thunderstorms and heavier downpours. This is a tropical wave, and it is moving to the north of Puerto Rico, Hispaniola. It is to be named Cristobal sometime during the week.
Watching the tropics, and we have tropical storm Cristobal. It's not moving much, only to the north-northeast at about 2 miles per hour. And it is a tropical storm with sustained winds of 60 miles per hour. It's been hammering the Turks and Caicos, Bahamas, with some drenching downpours and gusty winds. As we go throughout this work week, it does look like the storm is going to continue in a north-northeast track there and then turn to the northeast, becoming a hurricane category 1 by Tuesday into Wednesday and passing well enough to our south and east. Not going to impact us directly, but it could kick up the swells and cause some rip currents as we go into midweek, and that's right around when we're going to be warming. We've got Cristobal continuing to pass to our south and east. It is still a hurricane with sustained winds 75 miles per hour. It's a minimal category 1. It's moving to the northeast at 26 miles per hour, really picking up speed. Going to continue to remain as a hurricane through the day, even possibly into Friday as it moves off to our north and east. But it's kicking up those swells. So you keep in mind, we've got high surf, waves 4 to 6 feet, and we've got that high risk of rip currents today. So if you have plans to be out in the water, just use extra caution. Let you know about when
you can see now the rain battering the Big Island, the mountainous terrain of the Big Island actually weakening the storm, and it is going to continue to pass to the south of the island chain as we go throughout the day. Winds now sustained to 50 miles per hour, but behind it, Hurricane Julio, category 2 now. It was a category 3, so it is weakening a bit, but that looks to impact the island as we go through the weekend. Today,
watching the tropics still. This is for the Pacific, and you can see this is the spin. Oh, deal.
It is still a tropical storm with maximum sustained winds of 40 miles per hour, moving northeast at 6 miles per hour. Looks like it's pushed over land now. It could still hold its tropical characteristics as it makes its way into Arizona. And look at all the flash flood watches across the southwest. A lot of moisture from Odile. This is Polo. It is a tropical storm. Maximum sustained winds of 60 miles per hour. The good news with this storm, it looks to push more northwesterly, maybe swiping Baja a little bit with some rain, but not a direct impact, not following the same path that Odile did. This is Edward. You can still see a well-defined eye. It is located east-northeast of Bermuda, well over 1,000 miles west of the Azores Islands. It's moving northeast at 24 miles per hour now, and it has been downgrading. It's
weak. The models, some of them split, taking a little closer to Florida into the Gulf, and others taking a little closer to the East Coast. So it's something we're keeping a close eye on as we go into
of Odile now moving through New Mexico, and you can see the heavier downpours with that, and you can put it in motion. You see a little bit of a spin there. As we go southward, more into the tropics, into the Pacific, this is Hurricane Polo. It has been upgraded to a hurricane now, strengthening 75 mile per hour sustained winds. It's moving to the northwest, and it continues to take that track, not impact Baja directly or take a similar track.
It is beautiful out, and we've got these nice, comfortable temperatures, mid to upper 60s across the island. A fantastic
sun emitted masses of energy called CMEs, and the charged particles started to interact with the magnetic field of the Earth. Follows the magnetic lines of force into the polar region. So the further north you go, the better chance of seeing the lights. And that's always tends to be the trend. However, with this powerful solar flare, it's giving us a chance further south. So throughout the Hudson Valley, we could see
Jamie Booth.
Beautiful sunny day. We're nice and mild through the afternoon. Satellite and radar not showing much for our area. We have to expand it, see some clouds off to our north. This is along a cold front, and the cold front is going to continue to dip south and push through the area. It's just going to bring some clouds, perhaps for the evening, but then we clear it right back out through the night toward daybreak. Behind this front, see some rain showers into the Great Lakes and more rain showers into the upper Midwest, Iowa, Illinois, into Missouri. This frontal system is approaching our
area. You see the colors, the high colors throughout the northeast, indicated by the orange there. In some areas, seeing some peak color across the island. We're a low to moderate, so we are seeing those beautiful, vibrant colors, and we've got more time to see
them.
we do get some gusty winds over 40 miles per hour Saturday into Sunday as the low progresses off to the north and east. So a closer look at the
showing the clear conditions. We'll expand it. We had some showers into central New York earlier, but they have fizzled out and continue to push to the north and east. So that batch not impacting our area. And we'll put this in motion so you can see how they're continuing to move away from the area. We'll expand it a bit. There are more showers moving right into the Midwest, into the Great Lakes, now making their way into West Virginia and approaching Pennsylvania. This associated with a front that is going to continue to approach.
We're mild to start next week, but we are turning colder, and it's a typhoon teleconnection that's going to reinforce some Arctic air into the area. The remnants of Typhoon Nuri, now a massive post-tropical system impacting the Aleutian Islands. It is an extremely strong storm, and it's causing the jet stream to buckle. It becomes more wavy, so this allows warmer air to filter northward for western regions of the country, but then it pushes Arctic air southward for most of the eastern portion of country, even into the central plains, northern plains. That Arctic air will be in our area.
We get another reinforcing cold shot next week. All this due to a blocking high over the Pacific, over Alaska. It keeps sending in that Arctic air. So you can see the lake enhanced snow from the winds racing through, but a disturbance is bringing some of this activity as well. And as we go throughout today, this disturbance will swing on through tonight. It's a reinforcing shot of some colder air. We've got a low off to our south that'll continue to pass to our south and east. All this together brings us some rain and a little wet snow mix. And the more north you are, the better chance of seeing
that. Certainly a frigid afternoon. We have these strong northwest winds sustained 21 miles per hour in Glen Cove. It's making it feel more like 5 below. You got to have the layers as you head out.
New York, western, northwestern Pennsylvania, into Ohio as well, just getting dumped on. You can see all the snow rolling through the Great Lakes, even into Illinois, Indiana, and portions of West Virginia into Kentucky. There is a disturbance that is pushing through, also enhancing some of this
outbreak as we go throughout the remainder of the day into the next few days. This Arctic air just spilling southward, allowing those temperatures to only top out in the 20s with the wind chills below zero.
Volumes on how we've advanced the science, and we're learning. Obviously, we've had some pretty incredible storms since the 1800s.
Sure.
So we're learning from each storm that we go through, and we've had some major blizzards.
We can look at the past and learn from it, and that helps us predict the future and plan for the future. As we look at past seasons, past storms, and past snowfall totals, if we had an extreme amount or just a little amount, that can help us by looking at
really with each storm. We're learning from each storm. The atmosphere is teaching us more, and our models becoming more advanced as well. And we had a blizzard 1978. They were able to forecast that a few days ahead of it, but it was the storm of the century, 1993.
Five days out.
Remember that March? All of us remember that. Yeah. I mean, we're talking severe storms in the south and then snow all the way up into New England. So that was a major storm. 5 days out.
Again, one on our minds would be February of 2013. It was a blizzard. It dumped 30 inches of snow in Long Island. And along with that, there were 60 mile per hour winds. So it led to the wind pushing that snow and causing drifts to up to 4 feet. So anytime you have any kind of storm like that, it halts transportation, it brings the rails to stop, and they shut them down. Flights are canceled. It's hard to travel anywhere around this area. And we also had another storm just after Christmas, December 26th of 2010. A lot of people remember this one. This one dumped 30 inches of snow in New Jersey and 20 inches in Long Island, along with high winds, just the same. And this was a day after Christmas. So there were people driving from wherever they were at during the holidays and getting stranded in their vehicles and having to abandon those vehicles and walk and to get help and get somewhere otherwise. So it was certainly some dangerous situations.
A week, El Nino, it looks like that we're underway, and that's what we're predicting for this winter. And basically, El Nino, and so is the El Nino Southern Oscillation. It's the equatorial Pacific sea surface temperatures, and when they're warmer than average, you have an El Nino. When they're cooler than average, you have a La Nina. When you have neither, it's neutral conditions. That's what we had last winter. Now we're heading toward an El Nino, and it does look to be a weak one, figuring that the more warmer than average are, you get them real warm, it's a strong El Nino. This is what we're thinking, and it does play a lot into how the jet stream will bring in some moisture and how we're able to get some cold air invading the northeast. And I know you have a lot of points on what you're thinking of, where that moisture is going to go
for the most part, and what that really is going to play into how we get rainy storms, ice storms, snowstorms.
Ice storms are tremendously more dangerous than snowstorms. I think for the most part, this area, we're used to snowstorms. I mean, we're going through these totals here, and we've got some pretty significant years where we've got a lot of snow. But when we're talking about ice, you just need a little bit of ice accumulation to cause some extreme dangerous conditions. And statistically speaking, when we have a snowstorm, snowstorms do cause death, and 70% of those deaths during a snowstorm are accident related, car accidents, vehicle accidents. But when you have an ice storm, that number jumps up to 85%. It is so dangerous on the roadways. Just a little bit of ice can cause your vehicle to completely go out of control. You don't have control. In addition, the ice accumulating on trees and power lines bring down the trees and power lines. You're talking power outages for a long duration. And we've had some significant ice storms here in the Tri-State.
What does that mean for our region? Are we going to have a mild season? Are we going to have a cold and snowy season? And something that I think we really have to keep in mind is that temperature-wise for Long Island, the average temperature for the winter is 35 degrees, and the average snowfall is 25 inches. So just being an average winter of 32 degrees, that doesn't feel too cold, but that's colder than normal.
Right.
So it's these numbers that you really have to look closely to see what we're really dealing with, and is it a brutally cold, just a harsh, an intense amount of snow that we're going to see, or is it just something that's a little close
moisture
to average?
That.
Yeah, we get like that storm in the right location, the right ingredients.
Right.
We just need the cold air, and then you get the snow. If it's going to stay warm, then we're just going to see what we just
recently saw. In fact, on the West Coast, we're talking